really pleased to have. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm welcome to our honorable guests.
A warm good morning to one and all. I, Harsha.
And I, Aishwarya.
Welcome you all to the grand celebration of 13th Foundation Day of IIT Bhubaneswar. Foundation Day is an occasion to remember, acknowledge our own moments in history and envision the future with joy and glory. With this vision, let us cherish those achievements, glory, and years of excellence that has lifted our institute with great pride. Let us celebrate it with immense pleasure, as this is the 13th Foundation Day of our glorious institute, IIT Bhubaneswar. It's among the first new generation IITs, which was established on 22nd July 2008. It was an absolute momentous day for the people of Odisha, as it carried a huge importance being the first ever IIT in the state. It has been observed that IIT Bhubaneswar has globally become well recognized for creating outstanding graduates and new knowledge.
With great honor, I invite the chief guest of the day, Dr. G. Satish Reddy, the chairman, DRDO. He will be joining to grace the occasion virtually. I also welcome the honorable dignitaries to the dais, Professor R. V. Rajakumar, Director, IIT Bhubaneswar. Professor V. R. Peddi Reddy, Dean, Student Affairs, IIT Bhubaneswar. Professor Saroj Kumar Naik, Dean, Faculty, IIT Bhubaneswar. Let's give them a huge round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. It's a matter of great pleasure indeed to have such honorable dignitaries on our dais. Now, we will have our traditional lamp lighting ceremony to have a spiritual beginning to this day. I request all the dignitaries to move forward to light the lamp.
Thank you, everyone. Now, I would like to call upon the students to felicitate our dignitaries with bouquet.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's give them a big round of applause. Thank you. Now, I would request our Honorable Director Sir, Professor R. V. Rajakumar, to address the gathering with his encouraging words. Sir.
Good morning, everybody. Professor V. R. Peddi Reddy, Dean, Student Affairs. Professor Saroj Kumar Naik, Dean Faculty. Dr. G. Satish Reddy, the chief guest of this function, who is going to join in a short while. Esteemed faculty colleagues, beloved staff members, very dear students, members of media, both electronic and print, guests, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to greet you on this auspicious occasion of the 13th Foundation Day of Indian Institute of Technology, Bhubaneswar. We have completed 13 years of glorious past. We are on a very steep ascent now. And what we do today has a lot of implication for the institute to start with, its members, and very importantly for the nation. It is appropriate that on this occasion, we briefly recall the history of this institution, including its journey in the past 12 years. Recapitulate about what we are doing now and what we should be doing in the coming future. So I would like to make use of this opportunity to give my experiences about the past, present, and then what I have in my mind and I've been sharing, and then what the institute has on its mind in the years to come. You are aware of this fact that in 2009, on this day, the institution's foundation stone was laid in this very campus. The institute was functioning, though the institute started its journey from the campus of IIT Kharagpur. I'm a professor of that, you know, that institute. And it was started there. I was aware of how we begin IIT Bhubaneswar there at IIT Kharagpur. Subsequently, after 1 year, it was moved to transitory facilities. And when I took over in 2015, the institute has been functioning from 8 different transitory facilities, transitory locations. Within a very short time after my joining, all of us participated, the faculty and staff participated in a very contributory manner, took up aggressive steps, and we moved the residences of the students to this very campus. Fortunately for us, three of the buildings were ready and two of them were hostels. They were close to ready, ready state, and we further added to the constructions within 2 to 3 months, put up all services on war footing. We shifted the students and a few families to the campus. That was on 18th July 2015, Radh Yatra Day, a very pious day, not only for this region, but for the whole country. Thereon, the institute did not look back. It went forward and forward, and we completed the shifting by 14th July 2019. We had the honor of having the Prime Minister of India, Sri Narendra Modi ji, to dedicate the campus to the nation, and also President of India graced in the same year to be the chief guest of our sixth convocation. So that's how the institute went up step by step. Ahead of many of our sister second generation institutes, we started the creation of the second phase of our infrastructure with a very strong and well-defined planning activity way back in 2016 itself. The works got started in 2017, and right now the phase two constructions of the campus are visible to you at close to the finishing stage. While working on phase two, we also continued with phase one works. We could complete the building construction, though they were at a very primitive stage at that time for the academic buildings. We could complete all of them and shift the schools also in between. And that's how it has been going on at this institute. We did face some challenges despite our aggressive planning and then taking actions ahead of time. It appears that in our country, civil works do take time for completion. So therefore, the second phase works got somewhat delayed. So we have been delivered with the two hostels, Director's Bangla, and the rest of the buildings are yet to be added, and we hope to get these buildings added to the national infrastructure very soon. Today, our student strength stands at 2,455. Second largest amongst the second generation IITs. We have come from behind at a lower strength to go to the level of having the second highest student strength amongst all the second generation IITs. We have 145 of faculty strength and the staff strength as well. And very recently, about an year or year and a half back, the institute very consciously adopted a very ambitious target for the institute. Very boldly, the institute went ahead and made the vision statement of the institute very challenging. Whose meaning is that the institute should become an institute of the cream of the global class as early as possible. The statement says that the institute likes to be well respected for generating outstanding graduates and for creating new knowledge. It is very ambitious indeed, and it puts up a lot of responsibility on every one of us. We are aware of this challenge, but yet we realize that the whole nation is looking for attaining our past glory of having some global class institutions like Nalanda and Takshashila on this land, and took up this challenge and consciously made the vision very challenging and started working on it. Indeed, we had a number of successes in this direction. For the first requirement is that we offer education of at the standards of the cream of global class. Very simple, but very challenging. And similarly, we carry on research of that type. And also we put up all other supporting things, including creating infrastructure at low standards, and started functioning and working on this. I'm happy to mention that we are on right course. We have the initial successes in that direction, and these successes are very encouraging to every one of us, and also proves that it is feasible to build an institution which can place itself amongst the cream of the global class is very much feasible on this land in our country. So with that, I'm sure with all of our participation in this endeavor, we can make this dream of the country a reality. Simultaneously, I'm sure some of our sister institutions are also trying to have similar achievements, and I'm sure the country will have a number of such institutions to feel good about it. Well, this initial success has come up with a lot of hard work from each and every one of us. And that is it, nothing comes for free. So for every great achievement, you need to have the associated homework and effort put in. So therefore, on this juncture, I would like to call upon every faculty colleague and staff member of this institution to recapitulate this ambition and do their best in reaching the target as early as possible. Indeed, our teaching standards have come up very well, and I don't think our teaching particularly at this institute is second to anyone in this country. I don't think so. So that's the status we have reached. We need to further work on it, and we shall work on that. We defined a number of very relevant research areas as the areas of our research thrust, wherein we would like to build centers of international fame, addressing the problem of the nation and the mankind in general. Some groups like the climate science group has already attained a good success and already well recognized across the globe and known, and this group is known for predicting the extreme events like the cyclones 5 to 6 days ahead. And as a parallel to IMD, and IMD also uses our results for consistency check. And in this country, we are unique on that front, and we have extremely good global, well reputed other groups across the globe, and trying to do further improve the our research and the models that are being employed for further improvement. We are also trying to make a big mark in many other areas. Energy science is one area which we cannot ignore. We are trying to make a big mark. Augmented reality and virtual reality is yet another area where the country has potential to generate wealth. And we took up this area as and set up a unique center of excellence in this country. Similarly, we are aware of the need for the conscious need for coming out with important results in the area of utilization of water resources and finding alternative energy resources and finding solutions for the energy requirement of the nation as well as the globe, and started working in these directions. We're also working on some aspects like storage of hydrogen energy. So therefore, the institute is on good course, experiencing steep growth at this moment. And the steep growth should continue, lest our ambition, it will take longer than what is needed for making our dream of creating a global class of institution and the dream will take time. So unless we continue this good work in coming years. We also have a challenge on the learning front, whether we like it or not. The coaching system in the nation, through which we put our own children to have successes in entrance tests like JEE Mains and JEE Advanced. That system is not so healthy. So we have some gaps in that direction. We need to fill up those gaps on the learning front. The institute needs to further work on the learning experience better. So no doubt that the product, the students we get are shut down from the society by their parents and the society itself in the name of achieving success in the joint entrance examination, and therein some amount of national loss is happening. Well, we don't have much control on this, on that. We can certainly remember this fact and do the unlearning which is necessary at our institution, or institute like ours, and put that kind of system in place and see that the damage done, if any, is controlled. The institute has come up with a 42-acre, very unique sports facility. So sports and socio-cultural facility for sports and socio-cultural activities, and creating sports infrastructure of international standards to add to the sports infrastructure of this region itself. It's getting ready. So almost 70% of the work is over, and another 30% will make the facility fully ready. And we should make use of these facilities fully and see that our students, whatever was lacking in the upbringing of our students during the coaching days, is compensated at this institution. And they get their learning on that front to happen, at least at the higher education level in our institution. Friends, I would also like to further add to some of the actions we need to take at this institution. Let me also mention that all of you are aware of this fact that the institution could co-host the inter-IIT sports meet with along IIT Kharagpur, the first of the second generation IITs to do so. Though we are not doing anything for the sake of rankings, were we not working directly on the ranking systems, we have a far bigger objective. Therefore, we work on the fundamental aspects of quality and then creating global class institutions. Some of those fundamental aspects, maybe it is possible that the ranking systems have not graduated to the level of taking those fundamental aspects into their ranking systems. But we are conscious that there is no shortcut. The fundamental aspects are important. Therefore, we are working on such fundamental aspects. The fundamental aspects like high standards of functioning, very transparent way of functioning and governance, creating a global class of excellence in the infrastructure, in teaching and research. These are fundamental aspects. Then the institute is consciously working on it. For instance, and some of the things like creating a top class faculty of that standards is very challenging thing. And when you raise your faculty selection standards, one of the disadvantages you may face in terms of the typical ranking systems is teacher-student ratio. Teacher-student ratio would suffer. So it may make you figure a little lower than what you deserve in the ranking systems. But there is no shortcut, and to be an institution which should figure in the global class of, in the cream of the global class of institutions, there is no shortcut, and we need to create a faculty, the most fundamental resource, that is the faculty of those standards. Despite that, the ranking systems may not be looking at with a good respect, so we should be conscious about it and do it. I already mentioned about the other fundamental aspects. And I'm sure all of you have witnessed that with no compromises, the institution has been working on such standards. The excellence created has reflected in the way we offered education during the pandemic. The students had nothing negative to say. I personally had feedback of all sections of the students who are at their homes and taking education. They expressed a lot of satisfaction on the teaching standards. We also organized the laboratory partially. We're also bringing them to the campus to have their hands on with no compromises. And on examination front, we were the only institution went ahead the tide and graduated our outgoing batch with full honors and without compromise by holding pen and paper and comprehensive examinations by online. And the endeavor continued. We could also have the convocation organized, the real convocation organized with students' participation in a hybrid mode. In reality by online, in reality with physical presence, by online presence and virtual presence. Therefore, my dear colleagues, I would like to remind you that because of the participation of a number of sections of this institute and because of your participation, we could already set up examples for the nation. We could already represent the nation to say that this country also organizes such things and do not compromise on education. That is also our responsibility. Therefore, it is feasible for us to continue to set up examples to our country, not only for our hinterland, for the whole country. And let us continue to do so and be a very good representative of this nation and become one about whom the nation can be proud of. At least there is an institution which conducted examinations fully in graduating the students. This is one small thing. I'm not trying to boast about it, but a small example, a good enough example. And I'm sure such things can see to it that our country has a good representation. Not that our institutions take up steps like, you know, passing the students on without holding examinations. I'm not saying that it is wrong to do that. There are challenges associated. Students have also lots of challenges. Therefore, institutes somehow consciously took such decisions. We should also have institutions who go the other way and took up the others. do other things, outstanding things for such a huge nation of 1.35 billion of people. That's what I would like to say. That's where we have set up an example. Now, and we could protect the entire campus from COVID-19, except for a few cases during 1 month due to the outstanding work of the COVID-19 preventive task force we have. And I would like to mention the outstanding work done by the academics of this institution in running academics at high standards. There are many other things also that have happened. Some offices never got closed even during the pandemic, in the lockdown period in this institution. There are a number of sections which are responsible, who worked and which are responsible for this outstanding success of running the academics and then protecting the campus from COVID-19 during the pandemic period. There are many other things too which need to be done in this institution to consolidate ourselves. The standards we have set in, the institute should continue to function in those standards and also improve upon those standards in the coming years. We did have an outstanding job in planning for the infrastructure. Still, every day something or other goes wrong. Some negative surprise or other comes up. We need to be conscious about it, work for two to three more years on these, and see that the outstanding the infrastructure in top class standards are put in place fully. It's not yet been in place fully. So this is what we need to do. We need to further strengthen our research culture in the campus. Thanks to a number of colleagues, they came up all of a sudden with the good innovations and came up with as many as 12 products developed and including some solutions for drugs and also on blockers. But somehow, so in the last mile, we had a problem, and though products were successfully developed, we could not go to the level of marketing, though we utilized in our campus and some of the sister institutions. On that front, we need to go one more step at least from developing products for COVID-19 to more complex systems in this, which are required for this country. The COVID-19 taught us a lesson that we need to generate enough number of human resources. So in the area of engineering, bioengineering, the institute is taking steps to initiate courses on bioengineering. The last week's disaster on Dauli Ganga also says that we have some gaps in our disaster mitigation methods, in our disaster preparedness. Certainly, we need to take steps of this type. Taking the challenges in our hinterland. So at this institute, it is appropriate that we create experts for our river systems. We'd like to have a Mahanadi export very soon. We need to have experts for other river systems as well. And IIT Bhubaneswar likes to contribute immensely on the disaster mitigation methods and disaster preparedness. So use of electrical energy for vehicles is a challenging field. There is a huge requirement. Thanks to Niti Aayog. Niti Aayog is trying to also propagate this idea. And having realized this, institute is trying to take up some steps, but we need to make big strides in this area. So on the front of taking up challenging technologies which have strong deliverables, we need to further graduate at this institution. I would like to call upon all of our faculty colleagues to be prepared, to prepare themselves to take up such challenges. They don't need somebody's guidance. They can directly take some steps and try to come out with outstanding contributions in the near future. With this, a few statements about what is in store for us, what we need to do in the coming future. There are other things as well. The country has come out with an excellent document on NAP 2020. It's challenging to see how, what features of these NAP 2020 you can adopt immediately and make the education system more meaningful than what it has been is very essential, and we need to work out on it. There are many other things as well where the institute has taken up steps in carrying out in the near future and in the far future as well. I am glad that on this occasion we are going to felicitate some of our colleagues, faculty colleagues, who have been rated high by our own students. It is purely based on the student feedback. We are felicitating them. Some of the faculty and staff colleagues who have put up outstanding and meritorious service on this occasion, and the names are not yet announced, so we need to compliment all of them with an applause when they come onto the stage to receive those awards. Today, Dr. G. Satish Reddy of DRDO, he has a number of responsibilities to hold. He has consented readily to grace the occasion, though virtually, for being amongst us today. I would like to thank him profusely for agreeing to be with us today. He also promised that he will visit the campus. And he mentioned that he comes to this place a number of times in a year. We have laboratory like DRDO labs like ITR present here. And so that gives him an opportunity to come to this site very often, and he promised to come to our campus. So with these words, I welcome you all once again, including the chief guest and the guests, to the 13th Foundation Day ceremony of this institute. And I would like to once again compliment everyone on this occasion and wish everyone and the institute a grand and glorious future. Grand years to come and glorious future awaiting. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for your encouraging words and spreading positivity and hope in the air. I welcome the chief guest of the event, Dr. G. Satish Reddy here. He has joined virtually. Please give a big round of applause. Now, the time has come to honor the exemplary faculty whose work and achievements have set a milestone in achieving success of our institute. So, I request Dean Faculty Professor Saroj Kumar Nayak to announce the name of the awardees.
Director Professor R. V. Rajkumar, Chief Guest Dr. Reddy, Dean Students Affairs Professor Ped Reddy, other dignitaries in the room and online. I think Dr. Das has joined from the farthest from us, from Minneapolis, USA, colleagues, students, staff, ladies and gentlemen. It's my privilege to announce our Director's Commendation Award for the following category. So I'll request the faculty members to come and receive the award from Director. So we go first for the Teaching Excellence Award, and we have different categories. So Dr. Nirmalendu Acharya for obtaining highest score in small classes. And so while he's coming, I'll announce the second category award, which is for the medium classes, so that he can also come. So now, Dr. Nirmalendu Acharya. So Dr. Srinivas Pinisetti for obtaining highest score for the medium class size category. And Dr. Anup Homas for the highest score for the large class size category. And Dr. Srinivas Pinisetti again for coming here for obtaining the highest score for the overall category. So Dr. Srinivas Pinisetti, I request you again to come and receive the award for obtaining the highest score in the overall category. And we have a special award for teaching excellence for consistency in teaching over the year, over the semester, and the award goes to Dr. Rajkumar Gudru. Now we go to the next category, which is in the research, and this is the Director's Commendation Research Excellence Award. We have Professor B.R. Pediredi, who's here, so. And Dr. Subhranshu Ranjan Samantrai, Dr. Rajan Jha, Dr. Venugopal Arumuru. Thank you. So as teachers, we do three primary things: teaching, research, and service to the institutes. So the next category of our director's commendation for faculty outstanding service to institutes goes to Dr. Santanu Pal, Dr. Bharat Ram Ram Kumar, and Dr. Srinivas Bhaskar Karanki. Dr. Bharat Ram Ram Kumar. Dr. Srinivas Bhaskar Karanki. Thank you very much.
We are really privileged to have our faculties in this institute. It's because of them that our institute has become globally recognized. Now, I would like to request Registrar Colonel Dr. Subodh Kumar to address the personnel who have worked hard for the smooth functioning of the institute. Let's applaud for them for their dedication and determination.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It is a matter of great honor that this year we have total of 6 non-teaching faculty members who are selected for the Meritorious Award, the Director's Meritorious Award. The names are Mr. Chandra Vade, who is a programmer, Mr. Prasanna Kumar Das, officer on special duties, Dr. Gagandeep Kaur, who is the student counselor, Mr. Pradeep Kumar Patnaik, private secretary, Mrs. Suhana Parveen, who is the junior accounts officer, and the last, Mr. Tapan Kumar Mohapatra, who is assistant security officer. I invite them to please come over and take the prizes, take the award. Yeah, please come over. Okay, Mr. Chandra Vade, programmer, who is presently he is online and he is on leave, and tomorrow he will be rejoining. Mr. Prasanna Kumar Das, please come over. Dr. Gagandeep Kaur, please. Shri Pradeep. Mrs. Swan. Mrs. Suhana Parveen, Junior Accounts Officer. Mr. Tapan. Mr. Tapan Kumar Mahapatra, who is the Assistant Security Officer. Thank you.
Thanks everyone. Now I request Dean Student Affairs Professor V. R. Pedi Reddy sir to introduce the chief guest Dr. G. Satish Reddy.
The chief guest of the day, Dr. G. Satish Reddy, Director Professor R. V. Rajakumar, Dean Faculty, Professor Saroj Naik, and all the distinguished guests and colleagues and students. I welcome once again to this August function of the Foundation Day. It's a great privilege for me to introduce the very great personality of the country, Dr. G. Satish Reddy, as a chief guest of this function. Dr. G. Satish Reddy is the Secretary Department of Defense R&D and Chairman DRDO and also Scientific Advisor to Defense Minister. Sir, Dr. Satish Reddy, welcome you to this August function of 13th Foundation Day on the entire fraternity of the Institute. He is very well known in the country. I don't have to really introduce Dr. Satish Reddy for his contributions and services, but for the honor of introducing him, I would like to add few lines. Dr. G. Satish Reddy is well known for his significant contributions towards indigenous design development, deployment of diversified missiles and strategic systems, guided weapons, avionics technologies, and also for sustained efforts in advancement of aerospace technologies and industries in India. Dr. G. Satish Reddy was born in Nellore district of Andhra Pradesh, and he had graduated in Electronics and Communications Engineering from Jawaharlal Nehru Technology University, one of the popular universities well established at Anantapur in Andhra Pradesh, and also same university in Hyderabad for MS and PhD programs. He joined Defense Research and Development Laboratory DRDL in Hyderabad in the year 1986 and subsequently joined the Research Center Imrat, the brainchild of none other than our former president and missile man Dr. Abdul Kalam after its formation. From a young navigation scientist and system manager, he rose steadily, and after his multiple significant appointments and decades of sustained contributions to defense R&D, he has been now the distinguished scientist in September 2014 and was appointed as scientific advisor to defense minister in May 2015. As a scientific advisor, he significantly contributed towards the formulation of many national policies and was pivotal in evolving roadmap for self-sufficiency in missiles. He holds distinction of being inducted as Fellow of Royal Institution of Navigation at London, Royal Aeronautical Society, UK, and foreign member of the Academy of Navigation and Motion Control in Russia, which are the very rare honors that any Indian could get it for these coveted awards. He is an honorary fellow of CSI and Project Management Association of India, fellow of Indian National Academy of Engineering at UK, Associate Fellow of American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics, USA, and many other academies and scientific bodies in the country and abroad. He is also a recipient of Dr. Biren Roy Space Science Design Award, Astronautical Society of India Rocketry and Related Technologies Award, and has been conferred with honorary degrees of Doctor of Science by many leading universities in this country. With this introduction, which has, you know, a number of pages, but due to the confinement of the time constraints, so I would like to invite Dr. G. Satish Reddy to deliver the Foundation Day lecture of 13th Foundation Day of IIT Bhubaneswar. Sir.
Am I audible to you?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Very good afternoon and namaskar to the entire fraternity of IIT Bhubaneswar, the director, Professor Rajkumar, the various faculty members, Dean of the Institute, and also Colonel Subodh, who worked with me and was happy to see him sometime back, and the entire faculty members, students, and all others who are present there. Once again, very good morning to all of you and good afternoon to you and namaskar. At the outset, let me thank Professor Rajkumar for inviting me to this 13th Foundation Day of IIT Bhubaneswar, giving me an opportunity to interact with all of you. In fact, the place Bhubaneswar is close to me. Sometime back, Professor Rajkumar was mentioning about that. I keep coming to that place very regularly, as our laboratories in Chandipur and Dhamra, where the missiles launches take place, and I come there regularly to witness these launches and see, and also the technological developments. And we also have a couple of radar stations located very close by to you, and so keep going there also. But it is unfortunate on my side that I haven't visited your campus yet, and I'll try to correct myself, and in my next visit, whenever I land Bhubaneswar, I'll make it a point that I'll visit IIT Bhubaneswar. Also, Professor Rajkumar has been working with DRDO since long, even before joining as a director here, on many projects, working consent to the many laboratories, whether it is NSTL or NPOL and other things, where working on sonars and signal processing, radars, tracking and other related applications, and even the risk processor related applications, and as long as very old on CDMA communication related to Prithvi also, even the Prithvi missile related to the CDMA communication. So I salute his contributions to the defense and particularly various DRDO projects throughout his career. Thank you very much, Professor Rajkumar, for working a lot for DRDO projects. Today, even with IIT Bhubaneswar, we have projects running more than about, I think, 1.3 crore rupees worth projects on various aspects, whether it is stress corrosion crackings related studies, Professor Kishore Kumar Sahu, or online corrosion monitoring in naval structures, Dr. Subhankar Pati, assistant professor there. Then improving the damping capacity of cast nickel aluminum bronze, Dr. Partha Sarathy is also an assistant professor there. And then Professor Behra, working on development of formal verification tools for proactive assessment and prevention of security threats in enterprise network. These are some of the projects which are running with IIT Bhubaneswar for us. And I have been interacting with my scientists very recently. They have shown lots of interest in working with IIT Bhubaneswar on varieties of subjects. And I'm sure that we will be able to interact with you much more, and we should be having many more projects running with you. I will talk to my Director General Technology Management here in Delhi headquarters, and also the Director ERIPR, to work with IIT Bhubaneswar in multiple ways and see that you can become part of one of our Center of Excellences, which we have opened various places, and then take particular verticals and work upon them. In fact, we have come out with a scheme now called long-term partnership with academic institutes, meaning the partnership in that particular subject or area is for about 15, 20, 25 years, evolving technologies after technologies in that particular area. So for example, I'll give you, if you take advanced materials, it is an area what I think you can keep on working for hundreds of years also. Work on various materials one after other is one thing what a long-term partnership means. Or similarly, you take the example of radars, it's also continuously evolving field. See, we were talking about radars in a particular band using some tubes, microwave tubes, and generating the power. And then we went into now slowly into TR modules, transmit receive modules. Now we are talking about gallium arsenide, gallium nitride related, very small, tiny modules which can deliver high power. And we're talking about smaller radars delivering high power. And we are talking about removing all the gimbals and all that. We are talking about active electronic scanning array radars. And then we are talking about now further photonics radars. We are talking about over the horizon radars and so on and so forth. So it's an evolving field we should be able to have. So IIT Bhubaneswar, you can identify your strengths. There you will be having a proper department working on this particular technologies, and we can have a vertical where we can work as a long-term partner evolving into these technologies over a period of decades. This is one of the things what actually recently we have come out and we are ready to work with you. In fact, let me tell you, today DRDO is working very vigorously with various academic institutes in the country. There are about 295 academic institutes which are working with the DRDO, and we have an investment of about 1,000 crores into these academic institutes, about 1,000 crores, and lots of projects, lots of areas. We have about centers of excellence in many places working in specific areas. We have centers of excellence in IIT Delhi, we have in IIT Mumbai, they are working on as a center of propulsion technology. We have in IIT Chennai, we have in Hyderabad Central University, we have in Jammu University, we have in Mizoram University, we have in Bharatiya University. So many places we have centers of excellence, and we should be able to work on these specified technologies today. See, friends, like to mention that country today over the 3 decades or 4 decades, we have matured ourselves in technological fronts in many areas. India has actually matured in many things today. Now let me talk about the defense technologies. Today we are self-reliant in the areas of missiles. We are self-reliant in the area of radars. We are self-reliant in the areas of sonars. We are self-reliant in the areas of torpedoes. We are self-reliant in the area of electronic warfare systems. We are self-reliant in the area of AVAX systems. We are self-reliant in the area of fighter aircrafts now today, having got LCA fighter aircraft, which very recently the cabinet, Honorable Prime Minister, has cleared 80 the numbers of aircrafts from Indian Air Force on HAL, which is designed and developed by Aeronautical Development Agency and DRDO. 83 is the single largest ever order by Indian Air Force till now. It's a proud movement for the country to have 83 aircrafts of our own going into the Air Force as a single largest number. This is one of the important things. So similarly, we are able to develop Arjun tank. We have developed Arjun tank, which is inducted, the second Mark II, a much further graded tank, is also completed, and it is going to be dedicated by the Prime Minister on Sunday to the nation. This is another important thing. And so these are the areas. Today we are in communication systems, including SDR, software defined radios. We are self-reliant. So there are many areas in these defense technologies. When you say you are self-reliant today, and we are able to develop our own submarines, we are able to develop our own ships today, we are able to develop our own ships, which are carrier vehicles, aircraft carriers. These are also we are able to develop in the country. These are all the areas where over the decades country has worked on that. I don't want to get into the other areas, but you know, in the space also we have a Polar satellite launch vehicle, we have our own cryogenic engine based geostationary launch vehicle. We have done our own moon mission, we have done our own Mars mission, and Gaganyaan, where the man is being put into space, also is getting ready. So many things, we stand in all these things. We are one of the fifth nation, sixth nation in the world where we have achieved these technologies. And today with the ballistic missiles, having the ranges of ballistic missiles like Agni going to 5,000 kilometers, which is the ICBM class missile, we are one of the 6 nations in the world. Having got the ballistic missile defense program, which can counter an incoming ballistic missile in the mid-air at about 100-120 kilometers altitude, we are the 4th nation. You know that the anti-satellite test, which was done from Wheeler Island on the 27th of March 2019, meticulously done, a very highly complex and critical technology used, we have become the 4th nation in the world after America, Russia and China who have done such an operation. So we have matured in many of these technologies. We are the 6th nation who have developed their own mine battle tank. We are the 6th nation who have developed the light combat aircraft in the world today. And so technologies have matured. But I like to say one thing, friends, here. We have been generally technology followers. This nation has been generally, till now, in the last couple of decades after independence, we have been following. Meaning, somewhere the advanced nations develop certain technologies or technological products, and then we also develop after a couple of years, whatever the time period it is, we keep developing that and we also reach to that technological level. This doesn't work. It cannot be. If we have to capture the market, if we have to capture this technological development, we need to be the front runners. We need to develop these technologies first. This is what Honorable Prime Minister is also continuously mentioning. Even Dr. Kalam used to dream when he was there continuously. Whenever we were doing all these tests and saying that, sir, we have become the 5th nation, 6th nation, 7th nation, he used to ask, how many times I have to listen that you have become the 6th or 7th nation like this? When do you do the first of its kind system in the world, say that India has developed the first system? Today, if the country has to prosper, it is the technology which makes the country prosper. We have to be technologically advanced nation. we should be coming out many technological first of its kind products. We have to be continuously coming out with lots of innovations. This is what is the requirement of the country today. So if we have to do that, having got maturity in certain technologies today, we have to identify the technologies which are going to come after 5 years and 10 years and 15 years. We need to start working on those technologies today. We need to do the deep-rooted research in those areas today. If we have to do that, the fundamental, the starting point is you, the academic institutes. The academic institutes are the one where the basic research and then some amount of applied research is to happen. If we can do a deep-rooted fundamental and basic research in academic institutes and come out with applied research close to that, and then R&D organizations like DRDO, ISRO, Atomic Energy, CSIR and all that, will be able to take from that point from applied research to translational research, and then industry can take from that and will be able to produce the systems in large numbers with sustained quality and at a low price, then we will be able to win over the world market. That is what is required today. See friends, till about 4 or 5 years back, all the youngsters were moving towards only IT. Information communication technology, ICT area is the one where most of the innovations have come from most of the Indians. All youngsters working in that area. In fact, about 5 years back, I went to NIT Warangal and went to the metallurgy department. I was talking to them about the 40 students there working in that NIT, in that institute in the final year. About 35 had joined IT, metallurgy students. This is what was happening. But one thing today, in the last 5 years, the trend has changed. Lots of youngsters are coming up into multiple areas. I can see even defense technologies where nobody was entering, no youngster was thinking of. Today, lots of youngsters are coming up and working in this area in the defense technologies today. Lots of startups are coming. Lot of encouragement from the government and people who are working on today, they are talking about working on propulsion technologies. There are youngsters who are working on green propellant, electric propellant, high energy propellants, many areas. There are people who are working on composite materials. One student from Hyderabad, he came forward working on the composite rocket motor, which can withstand higher temperatures than the composites which we have today. So there are people who are working on many technologies today. Battery technology. There are so many startups which have come in the batteries technology, power supplies. You talk about lithium ion, lithium sulfur, lithium air, are talking about magnesium ion, sodium sulfur, metal iron batteries. Many things, lots of startups are coming up today and working on these technologies today. And there is lots of encouragement coming from the government today. Whether it is DPIIT, which is giving startups a lot of funding and support mechanisms, are the innovations being supported by the IDEX in the Ministry of Defense? Are the funding what DRDO is giving to various industries and specifically to startups also? We have a scheme called Technology Development Fund, TDF, which actually encourages whatever is being imported today. If someone comes saying that I will be able to indigenize this, and we are able to assess his technological capabilities, we are ready to fund that industry up to 10 crore rupees for just indigenizing this. Or even he can come out with an idea, which we call it as a Suomoto proposal, and say that this is a technology which I want to develop, and this will be useful for the defense of the country. Then again, after evaluation of his capabilities, we will be able to fund him up to 10 crores. This is what we have actually come out for with the MSMEs. Today we have funded more than about 25. Even the, for the students, we are coming out with a scheme which we'll be announcing very soon. Just passing out students in the final year, or just passed out people, or just established startups. If they are working with the incubation centers in the institutes like IIT Bhubaneswar, any good idea, and which is feasible idea, we are ready to fund 1 crore rupees. We want to enlarge it in a big way. Large number of students who are just passing out or passed out people and incubation centers who are working, who can work on these problems. We are ready to fund them in a big way, large number. This 1 crore, in fact, we have to take it to a large number. This is one of the things which you are proposing, so that people who are just coming out, how to enter into this, if they want to know, even the problems we have defined, go through the various websites, various products, you think about your own thing, whichever way, whatever way you can think, come out with the idea, we support you in a big way. Lot more things are happening. We are going to recruit youngsters in a big way into many of our mission mode projects, youngsters, youth. In fact, we have come out with a scheme working with Ministry of Higher Education, where 500 PhD students from various institutes, including IIT Bhubaneswar and places like that, we take them to work in our laboratories on defense problems. It is an MOU signed, which is a government letter issued, and letters have been sent from the Ministry of Higher Education to all institutes, including IITs, that the students can be sent to DRDO laboratories working there on defense problems. We wanted to have 500 such students working in our area. So these are all the various things which we are working out, and we are now introduced paid apprenticeship to engineering students and diploma students, even IIT students also every year. And we have been taking number of BTech and MTech students are their final year project. The 8th semester project of BTech and the second year project of MTech, we have been encouraging. On an average, we have been taking 4,000 to 5,000 people a year. So we want more synergy happening between academic institutes and DRDO scientists working very closely and trying to see that many advanced technologies can be developed in the country in a big way. This is what actually, unless the three fundamental main elements in this, the academia, the research organizations and industry work very synergetically, it is extremely difficult for us to move and come out with products which are state of the art and first of its kind products. And the timelines we have to reduce, it can't go in a serial way. That is why we have brought in industry works with us. When we take a development project, industry is becoming a partner right from the day one. We call it as development come production partner. He tries to understand, he tries to mingle with us, he becomes part and parcel of it. And then we are saying now even the army also joins, our armed forces join us. Together all of us are working, and a single trial will happen, making sure that all the product is realized in a very time-bound manner. So these are all the things. Friends, probably the country has organized a major event, you must be knowing, called Vaibhav on 2nd of October on Gandhi Jayanti Day, and the Prime Minister has inaugurated Vaibhav, Vaishvik Bharati Vaignan Summit. There, then it has been listed out in the famous academic institutes, the best rated academic institutes, which are first 500 academic institutes in the world, and various best R&D organizations. There are more than about 7,500 Indian famous researchers, professors and scientists working. All these have been brought out to one platform called Vaibhav, which Honorable Prime Minister addressed. And then they have discussed over about 25 days on various subjects. 80 subjects they have discussed, various people. And in these 80 subjects, they have discussed for about 732 hours. What is the present situation? How do we need to work? What is the way forward? How we can work together? What are the schemes to be brought out and all that? And finally, on 30th of October, the Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel Jayanti, and again, it was concluded. And the scheme will be a continuous scheme. And various professors, researchers, and academicians abroad who are Indian origin, they are ready to work with us. Lots of schemes are coming out. You all can look into it, Vaibhav Summit, Vaibhav website. You can see various people who have worked on that and what are the recommendations and all that also. We can bring them here. And the schemes also will be coming out soon, enabling academic institutes like you for working together with these academic institutes and with these professors, which actually proposes many schemes like the PhD students can be sent from here to work there for a couple of years. They can be a joint PhD guide, one guide here and another guide there, and together working, and 2 years working here, 2 years working there. That sort of schemes have been brought. So the many things which have been brought about, you know that there is a proposal which is going to the cabinet now to connect all the academic institutes in the country with a high-speed network, and the important departments in the government and R&D organizations to ensure that there is a seamless, continuous flow of information happening between all these academic institutes and R&D organizations and departments. So there are many steps which are being taken up to promote the research, the development, the technological advancements, and promote startups and industry. Even in industry, in niche areas, we are promoting research in a big way. We are trying to fund the industries for research and development in the industry also in niche areas. A very specific area where they are working, their products are coming out, they need to continuously update, and they can work with various academic institutes also for that upgradation of their product. This is another mechanism which actually government has brought in. So there are so many mechanisms we are trying to support. Firstly, a deep-rooted research in academic institutes, the students who are coming out to come out with research proposals or to establish industries, establish startups, and come out with innovative products is the major drive in the government today. We want to see that the country industry is flourishing, country is coming out with state-of-the-art products. That is the only way this country can become prosperous. We need to sell our products all over the world. The world should be flooded with Indian products. That can happen only if the product what we are coming out is state-of-art product, if the product is priced low, and the product is a quality product. A sustained quality is also very, very, very important. We keep telling the industry that for the first product or the 1 millionth product which is coming out of industry should have the same type of a quality. This is very important. And also I'd like to mention to institutes like you, the manufacturing technologies are very, very important. If you want to be your price of your product should be lower, you have to have innovative manufacturing technologies. We need to continuously work on that manufacturing technologies and develop the machines, the machinery, equipment here in the country itself, and try to make our manufacturing is priced low. This is very important. Friends, you see, in the country has got thousands of lathe machines and workshops and everything, CNC machines, and most of them are imported today. We should have our own machinery, our own equipment. You see the biomedical engineering, the complete equipment is imported. So we need to change this. See, in fact, the Honorable Prime Minister, he says we should be changing from one of the largest importer to a largest exporter. That can be achieved by a dedicated research from institutes like you, and then taking on from there by R&D organizations like us and industry. That is the way the country can prosper. I heard actually Professor Rajkumar's talk in the beginning, talking about many things where you can involve yourself and do a lot of development, whether it is COVID-related products and technologies, which were we all have suffered last year, and talking about technologies which are required for the operations which are happening in the Uttarakhand hilly regions today, are many things. Or actually how the region can develop with an IIT there in IIT Bhubaneswar, and you will be able to work for the all-round development of the state and region around you. Many technologies, there is no limit. Sky is the limit. You can be working on many technologies, many products. You can be continuously coming out, and we are there to support. We will be supporting whichever the way I mentioned many schemes today. So I wish that IIT Bhubaneswar will flourish in a big way, will come out with state-of-the-art or first-of-its-kind technologies, making the country proud and making the country prosperous. Work with us. Let us take the nation to the top of the world. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. My best wishes to all of you I wish IIT Bhubaneswar to become one of the leading institutes in the world. Jai Hind, Dhanyawad, Namaskar.
Value-added and research. Creative ideas for innovative India. Thank you so much, sir, for sharing this valuable information regarding technological advancements. With this enlightenment, we can surely bring laurels to our institute as well as to our nation.
Now, I request our director, Professor R.V. Rajakumar, to felicitate Dr. G. Satish Reddy.
Now, I would like to request Dean Faculty Professor Saroj Kumar Naik to give vote of thanks.
It's my true privilege to be asked to give the vote of thanks on this occasion. On behalf of the institute and on my own behalf, I thank Dr. G. Satish Reddy for really giving an excellent talk. We thank you for pointing out the long-term collaboration possibility in many frontier area of research, including for your kind offer for the incubation support. We'll definitely follow up with your officer. We also thank you for giving a tour of advanced defense systems that the country is doing and is in the frontier with the various different countries. We also thank you for pointing out that we can only excel to an extent, but beyond that, we need to be leader rather than follower. Of course, that is a challenge to institutions like us, and we are sure we'll rise to the occasion. This will not only point out and also lead our advanced research in various institutions, including IIT Bhubaneswar, but also it will provide high quality jobs, as you pointed out, in the manufacturing to our fellow citizens in the country. Thank you, Dr. Reddy. It has been wonderful for us for the last half an hour or so to listening to you and to see the challenge ahead. I also take this opportunity to thank Director Professor R.V. Rajakumar for his inspiration and for the guidance for this event. Thank you, Professor Rajakumar. A big thank you to Professor Pedi Reddy, Register Colonel Kumar, Joint Register Mr. Roth, entire registry, security team, engineering sections, and the entire IIT Bhubaneswar team, particularly many of them working behind the scene, for all the efforts for an excellent program for today. Last but not the least, thank you all inside the room and online for strong participation. Stay safe and be well. Thank you.
So thank you once again, Dr. Reddy, for your august presence on this occasion, and we'll look forward for your physical presence here as soon as possible. Thank you very much once again for an outstanding talk.